Change at any company is hard. Transformative change at a legacy real estate behemoth is among the most difficult challenges in business. Over the past 2 years, Colony Capital has gone from having a portfolio that was 80% traditional real estate to now one that is heavily focused on digital infrastructure. The company has a staggering $30 billion in assets in the digital space, from cell towers to fiber networks to data centers and small cells. The person behind that transformation is Mark Ganzi. He's the CEO of Colony Capital since last year and former head of Digital Bridge, which merged with Colony in 2019. He joins me now to talk about that shift and what it means for the business of real estate. Is owning digital infrastructure the new owning the railways? So Mark, thank you for being with The Real Deal.
Thanks, Hidden. Thanks for having me.
Let's start with, the shift first, right? When you're putting something together, when you have a giant company, right? A company with a long legacy on Wall Street for being a certain way. And then you take it in the span of 2 years and you turn it into something completely different, right? The name stayed, some of the people have stayed, but in every other aspect, it's pretty much unrecognizable. So can you talk initially just about that shift, what it means sort of culturally within the company, what it means when you talk to your investors, and what it means when you talk to the street?
Well, I think the shift started in 2017 for Colony. I've had a 30-year relationship with its founder and our former chairman, Tom Barrack. But really what Tom saw was that the world was changing. And the biggest catalyst for that was just the disintermediation in traditional real estate models. It started obviously in retail, what we've seen happen to big malls and what we've seen happen in the e-commerce space and in logistics and distribution. All of that has changed at a radical clip. You know, the pandemic then further accelerated some of that change in traditional real estate. You know, the way we're thinking about our office space, the way property owners are thinking about the future of commercial office buildings, the way, you know, we're all thinking about what does the lodging industry look like after the pandemic? What does the travel and leisure segments look like after this? And so real estate is undergoing a tectonic shift right now. And it's all being re-rated. I would say this re-rating started about 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And it was really that shift to the cloud. You know, once the cloud enabled e-commerce and goods and services and other things to travel quicker and more efficiently, it really allowed for people to rethink different types of real estate models beyond just fintech or prop tech or even digital infrastructure or digital real estate. And so when we made that joint venture with Colony back in 2017, we raised $4 billion in 10 months, which was a record for a first-time fund. We've now deployed that first fund. It's been very successful in terms of how those investments have performed, and the world has taken notice. But all of the thematics that we're pursuing now in our digital real estate business revolves around the future of where we see the world going. So as we think about 5G, we think about cloud computing, artificial intelligence, IoT networks, and edge computing, these are going to be the next big real estate models that people will pursue over the next decade. And so the asset class was shifting, right? Yeah. Traditional real estate was shifting. The verticals that we were chasing were shifting. And so all of these sands underneath our feet are changing. And at the same time, you've got this, as you said, a massive organization, you know, filled with tradition and legacy and people. And at the same time, we had to change our people. We had to change the narrative. And you did say something that was very accurate. A lot of people have stayed from Old Colony. Mm-hmm. And the reason we were able to move some of those people into the digital business is because really the underlying premise of our entire business is keeping tenants happy. Mm-hmm. If there's one thing that I've been doing for 27 years is we've always focused on our customers. And whether you're signing an apartment lease or you're signing a lease in a medical office building or an industrial property, the principles that existed at Colony Capital for 30 years are no different than what existed at DigitalBridge for 27 years, mm-hmm. which is we have great customers, we have to service them, we want to enter into long-term leases, and we want to be the landlord of choice.
It's almost like Coca-Cola going to Wall Street and saying, hey, we're going to be the number one purveyor of a healthy lifestyle. And here's what we're rolling out, right? So talk about conveying that message over time to Wall Street, gaining the confidence of investors when you did that.
Well, you just touched on a word that's really important is confidence. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things that I had to do was reestablish a rapport and a relationship with the street. And, the firm had been, admittedly so, by our former CEO and our former chairman, the firm had undergone a lot of distraction. And so my job was to remove the distractions, remove the noise, and, you know, begin to have a dialogue that was based on trust and transparency. And so when I got into the CEO chair a year ago, I told him yesterday, I said, look, I'm going to tell you, there's five things we're going to do, and we're going to execute them ruthlessly. And you have to trust me. I told them that I would rotate our asset base. I would get from, as you said, 80% traditional real estate, 20% digital, to 60% digital, 40% traditional.
And we did that. In terms of numbers, we're talking about $30 billion of acquisitions, all right?
We did. We did. We actually rotated $48 billion of AUM last year, mm-hmm. if you can believe that. It was just heroic. And it happened on both sides of the house. My legacy team did a fantastic job selling our industrial portfolio, our New York City office buildings at the right time, selling our Albertsons community shopping centers at the right time. I mean, these were verticals that are hard, right? Selling office buildings and retail properties and industrial in the pandemic was not easy. And then we sold our hotel portfolio. So we exited a lot of core verticals in the midst of what's arguably been the most difficult environment in commercial real estate since 2008. Mm-hmm. I mean, we haven't seen this amount of dislocation since the financial crisis. So that was hard. But we said, look, we're going to rotate the asset base. I'm going to de-lever the balance sheet. That was really important. I had to bring stability to the balance sheet. I inherited a balance sheet that was levered at about 12 times. I've taken net leverage down to 6 times. And then I said I would attack G&A and that I would attack it ruthlessly. And so we've now got our run rate, you know, G&A down to about $150 million a year. Mm-hmm. When I got here, I had a $300 million G&A burn back in 2019. I had 27 offices, 500 employees. And I was like, this is madness. We just don't need this many people. And people were critically important to the colony of old. And it helped build that franchise, that legacy, and that infrastructure. But we needed to disassemble some of that. And we needed to get the business lighter and more streamlined. So we did that. We took a lot of costs out of the business. We closed a lot of offices. We sold the corporate plane. We just did the things that we knew in our heart were the right things to do. The fourth thing we said we would do for investors is we would grow. And for the first time in many years, we would provide organic growth. And organic growth is the best growth. Get back to hardcore, you know, doing good deals, raising capital, and growing our FEEUM. And so we put some very simple, we said, look, we're going to deliver 15% organic growth in our IM business. And we ended up delivering 90% growth in 2020. So investors were really happy with that. We delivered good core organic growth. And that was the last piece of the puzzle, was just really transforming culture, transforming people, transforming the way people think about Colony. And I think what happened is, look, I inherited the company. I became CEO in July. Our share price was at like $1.60. You know, we got back to $7 a share. We've been trading in the high sixes again. So people are listening. People are taking notice. And I think we've just begun.
When you own the digital infrastructure, when you control so many assets that are going to be key sort of points for broadband, 5G, et cetera, you are in essence, owning the railways. Now, can we talk a little bit about that? And let's talk about where the economy is going and how Colony's new assets, so the digital assets, play into that.
You know, I really think a lot about, you know, the first digital wave hitting was about consumer to consumer, right? Mm-hmm. Voice communications, data. And then as we turn the corner and we move to more of a cloud-based environment and, you know, faster digital throughput in 3G and then to 4G, it was this notion of, okay, it's no longer C2C. Maybe it's consumer to enterprise, or enterprise to enterprise, or B2B, as they say. I really think this next decade will be defined by D2D. And so we talk a lot about device learning. We talk about device to device connectivity. We talk about IoT networks. You said it, artificial intelligence. You know, think about a Tesla for a second. You know, it consumes 4 gigabytes of data per day. Mm-hmm. That's a driving data center. Mm-hmm. It literally touches on a given day, depending on how far that car travels, it can literally touch 2,500 IoT sensors in its journey. So it leaves your garage, drive somewhere, goes to the supermarket, goes to your office building, wherever it goes. And it's literally communicating perpetually to the cloud. And remember, everything that's in a Tesla is cloud enabled, because mm-hmm. that's how Elon's built his infrastructure. And so that artificial learning, you know, which is based on NVIDIA microprocessors, which is incredibly intelligent, is looking at every decision you're making in that car. What are you listening to? How did you drive? Was it the most efficient drive route? Are you burning too much energy? What's the most efficient way to do it? Where did you park your car? Which grocery store did you go to? Oh, by the way, when you're in that shopping center and you got back in the Tesla reminds you, oh, you didn't go to the dry cleaners and get your wife's dress. Mm-hmm. Like, that stuff is not science fiction. That's happening today. Scary.
That, Mark, you could extend that out of automotive into living, into commuting, into
happening. Your office. By the way, we've spent a ton of time, you know, mm-hmm. talking to commercial property owners about this. Yeah. How is IoT going to change the office building environment? So in talking with Jones Lang and CBRE, you know, how are you, you know, what's your elevator cab management? What's your lighting system management? What's your HVAC management? What's your security management? How can you use all of those transactions that are happening in an office building to create a more efficient environment where we can bring carbon emissions and greenhouse gas emissions down by 20 to 30% over the next 10 years? This is, I'm sure, what Bob Zelenik is thinking about at CBRE right now, is how do we bring, you know, a more, a better user experience in that office environment, but at the same time, how do we reduce our carbon emissions, and how do we all fulfill our role as commercial property owners, whether you own a data center or an office tower or a hotel? It doesn't matter. We all have the same responsibility to the planet and to our investors. We've got to do a better job. And the way we get there over the next 10 years is exactly that: data, mm-hmm. big data analytics, data mining, IoT sensors, artificial intelligence, and helping our real estate make better decisions.
And I was going to get there, because one of the challenges right now that we face is, I don't know if you're familiar with New York Local Law 97, but it's put some very stringent caps on emissions in buildings above yep. a certain size. I want to say 25,000 square feet. The problem with that, Mark, is that it's kind of arbitrary. Size is not necessarily a great indicator of energy efficiency in a building.
It's not. Right? It's the population density. It's what goes into the buildings.
Right. What goes into the buildings, but also yeah. what kind of tenants you have, what sort of interactivity you have. Like having a sewing company in your building is less energy taxing than having, let's say, Palantir in your building, right? So yeah. there isn't so much in terms of asset level measurement at the moment. And I wonder if you guys can play a role in kind of getting buildings to a point where each building has its own sort of bespoke energy efficiency metrics, because that would be pretty powerful.
Well, I think you said it correctly. Look at what we're doing with cars. You know, 5-6 years ago, cars were not looked at as a data center, mm-hmm. right? I didn't think we were doing data mining in automotive, but we are. We're mining data in automotive, and it's helping us make decisions and how the cars ultimately operate, the routes that they take, the efficiencies. Same thing is going to happen in commercial real estate. It has to happen. New York has a rich history of creating regulations that almost get in the way of itself. And I think, you know, for New York to repair itself, it's going to have to be enabled through digital, right? I mean, a lot of what will bring New York City back is understanding how digital can transform the city, make it a better place to live. And you've got to embrace, you know, what's happening. And I believe the city will do that. It kind of has no choice. You know, it's a financial center, it's a powerhouse, it's a cultural center. But if it doesn't get with, you know, with the digital times, it's a city that can be left behind. Mm-hmm. It's not totally impossible. We've seen other big American cities suffer because they haven't adapted, you know, Detroit being one of them. And then you look at a city like Miami, which you spend some time in. I live down here in South Florida. Incredibly dynamic, embracing, you know, technology and digital and change, and companies are moving here in droves. People are moving their headquarters here, not just in financial services, but also in tech, because it's a place that's embracing that change. So I'm optimistic about the future of New York returning, but I'm also optimistic about other cities that are taking a progressive stance and understand the importance of digital. Pittsburgh being one of them. You know, we've done a lot of work with the city of Pittsburgh, Carnegie Mellon, and Uber, you know, creating autonomous vehicles that, you know, drive around the city, creating centers of innovation on edge computing in terms of using data centers on the periphery of the network, you know, to create better user experiences. So cities that understand digital and understand what to do, we're going to move forward. Cities that don't understand digital are going to move backwards.
I'm curious about how you do valuation in your space, because one of the things I was really grappling with, so for example, if you own an office building in, you know, Grand Central District pre-pandemic, you're like, okay, rents are increasing by a factor of, let's say, 10, 12% a year, whatever it is.
Yep.
This is how I can kind of map out the building's valuation over time, right? With your space, it doesn't move in a linear fashion at all, right? Because the more digital the more a digital ecosystem is embedded, the more valuable that your assets get. But it doesn't happen. It's not a steady thing, right? Something could change in the digital landscape, which makes your asset 10x more valuable in a year, for example. How do you, as an acquirer of real estate, as an investor of real estate, how do you think about that?
As digital real estate, there's four key value drivers. One is the scarcity of the permits. Mm-hmm. The second is the quality of the underlying cash flows, just like traditional real estate. So if you've got a 25-year lease with Verizon versus having a 3-year lease with, let's say, you know, T-Mobile, the 25-year lease of Verizon is going to be better than a 3-year lease with T-Mobile. So that increases the value of the real estate. I think the growth drivers are very important in digital. So for example, if you've got an asset that has, you know, 20% CAGR growth in terms of organic free cash flow growth. So if it's a data center and you keep adding more racks each year and those racks exponentially increase the rents, that inevitably affects the cap rate. So a high growth digital asset is going to command a very, very tight cap rate. That's really important. And then I think the fourth thing is how you finance the asset class. Mm-hmm. Just like, you know, you talked about owning that really great office tower in the center of Midtown Manhattan. Well, guess what? You can securitize that super tight because 80% of the rent roll is investment grade and the weighted average, you know, office lease is 8 years in duration. You know where that's going to price. It's going to price tight. It's going to be single A and it's going to price inside of 2%. The same thing is happening in digital real estate. Bondholders are moving to digital real estate because they like the duration of the leases. They like the quality of the cash flows and they like the predictability of the earnings, mm-hmm. which they're not getting in traditional real estate anymore because of this disintermediation that you and I talked about. So permitting, contract duration, growth, and financing. Those are really the four vectors that impact value. And if you hit on all four, you're right. An asset's worth 30 times or 40 times cash flow, mm-hmm. which is crazy. I mean, that's totally confounding. That's trading inside of a 2 cap once you're at 35 times cash flow.
But you know what I find interesting? So look at fintech, for example, right? When companies like Stripe started out, they had this total addressable market figure, right? Hey, we can capture this slice of the market. But what they couldn't even account for is the entire market change. Stripe is now worth more than the entire fintech market was worth 5 years ago.
We finally get to play offense, right? We've already told the street we'll be 90% rotated to digital by the end of this year. Those building blocks are now in place. We know the things that we're selling and we know the things that we're buying and we know how much capital we're forming. So it's a very clear roadmap to where we see ourselves by the end of this year. And you're right. I mean, if you think about if cloud computing continues to grow at, you know, 20 to 25% CAGR, our cloud data centers on our balance sheet are going to be worth 20 to 25% more, you know, in a year. It's easy to do that math. We're just scratching the surface on edge computing and then having networks that service 5G and IoT networks and help drive some of that artificial intelligence. That's also super important. So we're working both sides of the fence at the same time, but the key is to be in the landlord business where your tenants are growing, right? That's always where you want to be. Whatever real estate business you're in, it's a simple truism that I learned, you know, under Peter Linneman, you know, at the Zell-Lurie Real Estate Center at Wharton, was you gotta skate to where the puck is going. You don't skate to where the puck is.
So taking that Gretzky analogy one more step further, right? We talked about IoT, the Internet of Things. Can you maybe map out a scenario which is when it's fully realized, when it's creatively done at scale, what could it look like in an office building? What could it look like in a residential complex? What is sort of your dream scenario for that?
Well, I think, look, your dream scenario sits here, right? Mm-hmm. This will be your everything when you walk in office building. So you'll walk in, there won't be security anymore. Security will be some sort of gate. You'll flash a barcode. It'll say, go into the building. Or you'll flash your barcode and say, yep, the elevator's now been activated. You have a meeting at 11 o'clock. You're going to go to the 27th floor and get in cab E. So you walk down to cab B, you get in cab B, it takes you to the 27th floor. I think the other thing that's interesting is because we're all carrying these, we have GPS devices. Mm-hmm. So it's tracking our movements. And then everybody has some sort of fitness attachment to you that says, you know, what your heart rate is, where you're going, how many steps you take. And then we can use thermal imaging of human beings to figure out how much emissions each person is using in the building. So we know how to optimize the HVAC. We know how to optimize lighting, right? And once you can optimize cooling and power, you can really bring down the total consumption in the building. So ultimately, these devices will dictate, you know, how much cooling is happening in your segment of your office building and then whether or not your lights are on or off. And so that efficiency and energy is going to reduce emissions. And all of that is going to be based on an algorithm that's based on hitting when you're moving, where you're going, and how often you're going. And so we're using that artificial intelligence to predict power consumption, HVAC consumption, security patterns, everything that's used to operate a building. And oh, by the way, you know, most floors in office buildings will be cleaned, not by a janitor. They'll be cleaned by a robot that goes around and just has, you know, barcode sensors that open doors so that all that cleaning can happen at night. But if nobody's in your office building that day, it won't go clean there.
Yeah.
It's only going to go clean where it has to go clean, right? It's only going to use cleaning products that need to be used.
It's probably going to learn patterns. Like it might be like, okay, Mark is a, you know, loves burritos. And I, at some point I know that
I do love burritos. Who doesn't?
At 10 PM, I'm going to go and there's going to be a pile of sort of burrito. There's some learning, some intimate sort of tenant level.
It's pattern recognition,
right?
All algorithms are based on pattern recognition. Same in a tower, a multifamily office tower in New York City or in Los Angeles, the phone will dictate what you're doing once again. So you'll walk into your apartment building, you know, you won't need a key fob for the elevator. You just flash your phone. It takes you to your floor, right? The minute you enter your apartment, it already is predicting what's your favorite show to watch. It's going to put on for you. Maybe it puts on Bloomberg, or maybe it's a certain type of music you like. It's going to tell you immediately what was delivered that day. It's delivered the right amount of, you know, Pellegrino water, butter, eggs, you know, whatever it is you have. Remember, that refrigerator already knows what's in there, and it's already talking to Amazon Prime, and it's already telling you what needs to be replenished. And so if you choose to go on an auto buying pattern, your apartment or your home will be refreshed with the materials that you don't have anymore. So if you've run out of shampoo, it'll know that. If you've run out of Tide, it tells you that. It knows that, for example, every morning when you wake up and you get on your Peloton, it knows that you want to watch CNBC. So it puts it on for you. So all of this is just learning behavior. And you always have the off switch, right? You always have the capability to say, no, thank you. I'm going to turn it off. And we can do that. But once I find that, you know, we're creatures of habit, we like what we like. And generally speaking, you know, 90% of those decisions we'd certainly like made for us.
And you're attacking it from, I guess, from a really interesting perspective. One is you own some of these assets that we're talking about. Two, with your fund, with Digital Colony Real Estate Partners, what I forget the name of the fund, you're also able to invest in some of these companies delivering those services, right? The SaaS companies, the other companies. So talk a little bit about that fund, how it plays. It seems like more than just owning the real estate, you're trying to sort of sit at the center of that ecosystem.
We want to be the enabler of converged networks. I mean, that's where we sit at the corner of state and Maine in digital. And so, you know, those old traditional silos like data centers and towers, that was easy. You know, we did that in the 90s. We did that in the early 2000s. I think the stuff that we're doing in the future is exactly around that, is how do you enable connectivity to the next level? You know, and how do we bring connectivity closer to the consumer, closer to ultimately an enterprise, and then ultimately, how do we bring it closer to the device? How do we enable that Internet of Things connectivity? So a lot of that is happening in what we call edge computing. That's probably the biggest thing that you and I will talk about for the next 10 years. Is how do we bring a low latency, you know, device and customer experience to the edge of the network?
I was listening to the head of Blackstone's sort of technological investing, Tyler Henritz. I think he's a guy you might know pretty well. But he was talking about how in the logistics space or in the industrial space, a good has so many more points of, like, it sort of lands in so many different places. So based on that, he said, okay, look at the growth of e-commerce. Look at how many times a good has to go through the industrial pipeline. Based on that, I know that I can buy a ton of industrial real estate, right? I can see the demand sort of mapped out for the next generation. With the growth of e-commerce, with the growth of industrial, how does it change the dynamics of your business?
Well, I think we talk a lot about it. It's smart logistics, right? Mm-hmm. And what does smart logistics mean? I mean, it's not traditional industrial as perhaps Hitton, you and I have known it. I think it's understanding that the design specifications of a new industrial property has to have different ceiling heights. Mm-hmm. You have to have different size loading docks for autonomous driving vehicles. You now have to create an area where we're going to have drone pads taking off and landing in terms of being able to distribute goods and services there. You've got to have IoT sensors throughout the entire industrial park, because as an Amazon truck drives in, you want the IoT sensor to track everything that's on that truck before it gets to the property.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So immediately when it ultimately arrives at its place, you have every SKU code, you know exactly where the goods are going and what goods are coming on. It's that type of efficiency is where smart logistics have to go. And a great enabler of that is CBRS radios, the mm-hmm. new technology that the FCC just launched. And so that's enterprise 5G communications. So what we can do as property owners is we can set up wide area networks. So the ability, once again, to bring wireless and applications and bring it together and then impact the enterprise is where industrial real estate is going. So imagine a huge port, right? One of the largest shipping ports in the United States. Hundreds of thousands of containers coming in and out every day. Yep. And ships waiting outside, you know, the port that wait, you know, 2 miles offshore, 4 miles offshore. IoT sensors sensing those ships, knowing what's on those ships because it's picking up an RF code, an SKU code inside that shipping container. So by the time that that ship comes into port, every piece of good has already been mapped. We're working with the federal government. We're working with Homeland Security to define which container is sensitive and which one's already pre-cleared. So now you're speeding up supply chain, right? Because you know the crates that can come off and have been cleared. The ones that are not cleared go over here, they go to customs. Mm-hmm. The ones that are cleared already get on a rail line or they get on a truck and they're gone. And ultimately, what can we do? What can we do is we can reduce cycle time. Cycle time is the time it takes for a ship to turn. So if you can make a ship turn 25% faster, then you can ultimately get goods and services going to a place faster with zero human intervention, right? These are autonomous cranes mm-hmm. putting shipping containers onto rail carts, putting them onto 18-wheelers that drive autonomously, boom, they're gone. Like that's next generation thinking.
You couldn't solve the Suez Canal crisis, but you can do a lot of other things.
But that's what they're doing in Panama. They're trying to figure that out because right now in Panama, you've got goods and services that sit for 10 days to 14 days outside the canal.